One of the more basic questions I've been asked by several people here lately is what we keep hearing the word thrown around, but what exactly is a vector? Now, I've got some examples of vectors here, but that doesn't really explain what a vector is. So it would be impossible to explain what a vector is without going into the two different types of computer graphics that are used, and I'll just briefly touch on this, and that are raster graphics and vector graphics. Now, you're probably already familiar with a raster graphic, even if you don't know it by that name. Raster graphics are the bitmap files, PNG files, JPEGs, that standard photographs and normal computer graphics are made of. And in a raster graphic, the image canvas, for lack of a better term, is divided up into a grid. And each square of the grid is known as a picture element or pixel. And each pixel is assigned a color. It's given color data here. So in this case, we have one green pixel with nothing behind them. But even though it appears to be nothing, there's no such thing as blank space in a raster graphic. All of these are assigned the color white. So basically, a raster graphic is a grid that's divided up into squares, and each square is given color information. Now, our CNC software can't interpret color information. Now, if we go into something simple like Microsoft Paint here, and I've chosen this because because every version of Windows has Microsoft Paint. If we go into Paint and I draw a line using the color black, and I start here and bring that over here, it looks like, you know, I've got a line. I should be able to program a tool to follow that line. The problem is, in this image, all I've done is I've changed the color of the pixels that make up this line from white to black. All of this is still white. And our CNC software, again, just isn't equipped to interpret color information. Instead, what we have to use is another system known as vector graphics. Now, vector graphics are different from raster graphics in that they're mainly theoretical. They don't actually technically exist. What a vector is, it's a graphic representation, a visible representation of the complex math the computer is going to use to move a tool from one point to another point. It doesn't actually exist. It exists only so we can see it. Now, all vectors have to have these four elements. They have to have a starting point, they have to have an ending point, they have to have a length, and they have to have a direction. Now, for our purposes in CNC, having a starting point and an end point will determine the length and direction. Okay? So, at its most basic level, that's what a vector is. It's simply a graphic representation of the math the CNC software needs to do in order to move a tool from one point to another point. So when we go back into VCarve and we look at these vectors here, we can see, if we select a vector and I type N to go into node editing, I have a start point as represented by this green point here, as represented by this green point here, and an end point represented by this black point there. That gives me my direction, that gives me my length. So all four of those requirements are satisfied. In its most simple form, that's what a vector is. Now, a vector is not a line, but a line is a vector. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean that there are three basic types of vectors, and everything else is based on these three types, and that is the line, the arc, and the curve. Now, an arc is pretty basic as well. It's defined as a segment of a circle that has a known radius. Now, that radius may or may not be known to us, but it is known to the computer. Generally speaking, what we'll do is we'll enter a start point, a stop point, and then move the center point to determine that radius based on what we think looks good or fits our design. Now, I've got my arc selected here, and if I enter node editing mode by typing the letter N, I can see my start point here, my end point here, and here is my center point. This center point determines the radius of my arc. The distance from the start point to the end point determines the length of my arc. And those are about the only things I can edit on an arc. I can come up here to my center point and left click and drag this center point down to increase the radius, or I can drag it back up to decrease the radius. But you notice when I get to a certain point, it stops, even though my cursor keeps going. That's because what I've done is I've reached the maximum radius of this arc. There is a imaginary center in this arc. And what I've done is I've made this measurement from this point to that imaginary center equal to the measurement of this point to that center and this point to that center. So I've gone out to its max radius, and that's as far as it'll let me go. I can bring it back in, and when I do that, I increase the radius of the arc. This segment of the circle is half of the circle, so I can go no further than the radius. But if I come down here a little bit, I've increased the radius from, let's say, a 3-inch radius to maybe a 12 or 15-inch radius. Now, my imaginary center point is moved. My length has not changed. Only the radius has increased. Because as I move this center point of my span, I'm also moving the center point of the circle and making the segment of the circle smaller as I go. I hope that makes sense, and I didn't just add to the confusion. About the only ways that you can edit an arc is by changing the radius by moving this center point up and down, or by moving either the start point or the end point to lengthen or shorten the length of the arc. Now, that may have the effect of changing the radius, but the radius is generally controlled by this center point. Okay? So that's the only ways you can edit an arc. A curve, on the other hand, may look similar to an arc, but it's not restrained to a known radius. And in fact, a radius isn't even required. If I select the curve in node editing, we can see we have a start point and we have an end point, but we also have these clear points out here that are tethered to our start point and our end point. These are control handles. This type of curve is known as a Bezier curve. And a Bezier curve is editable by grabbing hold of one of these handle points and moving it. We can move it in around the center of that, in this case, start point, and change the angle, change the orientation of our curve. It can go above the center, or it can go below the center. It can go parallel to the center. It can go basically in any direction we want it to go using the point that we're editing as its pivot point. We can further distort the curve by grabbing hold of a handle and making it longer, which has the effect of lengthening the curve and distorting it from this corner, leaving this corner untouched. This one can also be moved and drugged to either fit a pattern or create the geometry for a new pattern. And once I click off here to deselect it, we can see what my end result was. So curves are completely editable in that regard. The most basic of the vectors are lines. And here's an example here of a line. These are also editable, but basically a line is a straight projection from your start point to the end point. That's at its most basic level. They can be edited, meaning they can be shortened, they can be lengthened, they can be moved to change the angle or change the position. But predominantly, they are simply connecting point A to point B. Now, you may have also heard of a polyline. A polyline is another type of line that simply has more points along its path. A polyline, such as this one right here, instead of just going from point A to point B, you have point A, B, C, and D. Well, what's the advantage of that? The advantage is simple. We can grab a hold of one of these points and change the geometry of that line, making it no longer straight, or adjusting it as our needs be. Now, as I said before, all vectors have to have a start point and an end point. They can have anything else along the way, but they have to have a start point and an end point. And in the case of a circle or a square or a rectangle, any kind of a joined vector, the start point and the end point are the same point. That's what determines whether you have an open vector or a closed vector. If the start point and the end point are the same point, it's a closed vector. If they are separate, it's an open vector. Okay. And you're also not limited to having either or. A person could come along in this case here where I have a four-point polyline, and we can put our cursor over this center span, and you see that little curly tilde shows up underneath the arrowhead of my cursor. And that just lets me know that I'm over the vector. I can right click and I can change that span of this vector to a Bezier curve. Gives me my two handles here and here and lets me control the shape of this span. Click off to the side to deselect it, and that's what I'm ended up with. By the same token, I could come along to this vector, come down to about here, insert a point, come down here, insert a point, and convert this segment to a straight line. Now, this is a separate curve. This is a separate straight line. This is a separate curve, but right click to get out of node editing, it's still all one single vector. So knowing what a vector is, knowing the basic types of vectors, and knowing a little bit how you can control them, how you can edit them, and how they can be made to work for you will give you a little bit more flexibility in your designs and allow you to create more complex shapes and vectors for your CAM designs. So, I hope you got something from this video. If you did, I'd appreciate a thumbs up down there. If you'd like to get notified the next time I post a video, please consider subscribing to my channel. But whether you subscribe to my channel or not, I'd like to thank you very, very much for watching. Y'all take care.